Jason Mayhew, Tony Caranco, and your host, Wes Underwood.
Well, welcome into the Sports Timeout Podcast brought to you by Jefferson's 75-cent boneless wings on Wednesdays, or my favorite, free pickle Fridays. Free fried pickle Fridays, that is. But yeah, and they got a Super Bowl special. You got to go to their Facebook page for that one. It's changing. It's like even Billy, the guy over there who's the, manager, didn't even know what was going on. He's like, it just keeps changing, so come in on Sunday and find out, because they've had Chiefs specials all week this week. So, but yeah, and then Robert's Integrative Dentistry in Joplin, ready for a wider, straighter smile this Valentine's Day. Be sure to get your scheduled appointment today at 417-622-0404. Press that special someone with a brighter, straighter smile, and like Tony said last week, get rid of that stanky breath. Don't want to go into your date with the, skunk smell or garlic or, all that stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Freshen up a bit. But, yeah, Wes Underwood, Tony Jensen out this week, and we bring back in Clint. And how's it going?
Whoa.
Who's the other team there? Team one.
Yeah, this is for all you MSSU intramural heads, of course, Team One, that I think won two games back in 2014, representing. If you're watching the video, you can see Team One.
Robert's Integrative Dentistry. Starring Robert Blake.
Yep, Blake was in it, so he got broke a tooth playing that and decided to go into dentistry.
Yeah,
I think it was something else. So Stephen Holm, a bunch of friends. So, but I'm here now to talk about.
Bye. Shout out
our
to Ty.
Chiefs. Yeah, Ty.
Jordan Baker.
Absolutely.
Jordan Baker. Me. You.
Actually, couldn't tell you who else was on there, but.
Dirk Nowitzki.
And Dirk, yeah. Which is kind of unfair, but the fact that we lost every game was weird. But, yep, we had 7-foot Dirk on there.
Yeah, absolutely. I still won't forget getting knocked to the floor by, I think it was Adams was his last name.
I could see that. Probably someone that like played high school basketball.
Yeah. Dominated us.
Yeah. Decided not to play that college, but just dominated.
Threw me down to the floor.
Main thing I remember about that was that I didn't, I was technically like a fifth year senior. So I had to I didn't actually have access into the gym. So I had to like sneak through an elevator to get in.
Yeah, let's get him down the elevator, Steven.
So I'm playing for the team, but meanwhile, I'm like 23 and sneaking down the elevator and playing with you guys.
Good times.
Yeah. No one was hurt by that. There was like six people on our team. So it wasn't like I was.
Who's this guy?
Anybody.
He was here last year. He filmed everybody, so we're good.
Yeah. There's a count.
But yeah. Well, before we get started, go ahead and make sure and hit that subscribe and follow button on YouTube right there. Yeah. First up, I got a chance to sit down with former Chiefs 1984 first round draft pick and rookie defensive player of the year, Mr. Bill Maas. And we talked Chiefs, a little bit about his career, and then we got some Super Bowl predictions. So take a look at that. And we bring in former NFL defensive rookie of the year, two-time first team All-Pro, two-time Pro Bowler, former NFL analyst for Fox Sports. He played in Kansas City and in Green Bay. Mr. Bill Maas, how are you, sir?
Great. I'm doing great. I mean, how can I not be? Chiefs are thriving, and I'm living right here in it.
Yes, and it's a good time to be a Chiefs fan for sure. I mean, little disappointed in these bandwagon fans because we had to hear from them all off season, and then during the season it was pretty bad too. It's just like you got to trust the process.
Yeah, it's kind of funny to see what has transpired, especially, since I came to Kansas City and became a Chief over those years through some of the hard times in the 80s, then to the Marty Schottenheimer playoff Chiefs, and then where they're at right now. So there's a lot of new fans, so to say, on that bandwagon.
Indeed. A lot of, if I guess you're going to say it, probably Swifties for sure. That's definitely a new fan base for Yeah.
That's a big fan base, right? I mean, they jumped on board as well. And it's pretty cool. You know, I see a lot of negative stuff posted about that. But, you know, I think it's cool. Yeah. Right? I mean, it doesn't bother me one bit if they cut away after a touchdown and they show her jumping up and down in the suite. I love it.
Yeah, it is awesome. I mean, it isn't any different than Tech Nine going to the game. It isn't any different than when they find Dante Hall. I mean, stuff like that. Because they go to those two guys a lot because they are there a lot. And, I mean, fans love it. They don't care what's going on in the game sometimes, especially if we're down. So when they go over to those guys and you get that kind of energy boost, I mean, when you got Neil Smith banging the drum, you got other guys like that coming back to bang it and hit it hard. And Tom Bahali, the most recent one, it's just like, okay, all right, we're fine. So
yeah, I mean, all those guys, you can cut away and see, like you said, Tech Nine or the mayor, Quentin Lucas, Kansas City, or Neil Smith banging the drum or anybody else. I mean, it's just another fan, and she's on board right now. So I think it's great. I mean, what the heck? I've never, you know, not minded looking at a 6 foot tall, beautiful blonde. So but why not? Cut to her.
All right, well, we'll go ahead and continue talking Chiefs, and we'll get to the good stuff here. And fourth time in 5 years, they earn a trip to the Super Bowl. Everyone counted them out for the second year in a row, and they go back-to-back again for the second time in those 4 years. Or, well, 5 years, but 4 years now in general. But what are your thoughts on how everything has played out this year thus far?
You know, I heard it all from everybody, the fan base, all year long. This isn't a playoff caliber team. This isn't, and all the stuff that goes along with it, you know, about the receivers and drop passes and all those things. But they didn't really see what was happening to the team. The team found different ways to you know, overcome obstacles, and that's what every year is. It's obstacles. Yeah. You know, your opponents are going to change. The game's going to change. Mm-hmm. Each and every team you have that year is going to have a different personality than any other team. And as a fan base, we were sitting there thinking like, oh, well, this is going to be the same old Chiefs and it's just going to be better because we got this and got that. And that's not the case. Each year it takes on its own personality. But I think what galvanized this team is, you know, the quarterback.
Yeah,
without a doubt, he's going to find a way, regardless, and he's going to bring you along. But the coaching staff also changed it as well. Late in the season, I think after that Raiders loss on Christmas Day, that was. Yeah. I think things changed then, and I think that the coaching staff said, you know what, we need to play team football.
Yeah,
and here you are at that point juncture in the season, week 17, and you're going to change up what you're doing. And think about that, how lucky we are to have that many wins to carry us to that point and then change up what you're doing. And change up, they started relying a little bit more on the running game, the offensive line, you know, play the field position, play to your strength, which is your defense. Kick, you know, shorten the field, long drives, chew up the clock, think things that we haven't heard in the last 4 years from a Chiefs offensive perspective. But that's what they did, and it's working, and it's carried them through the playoffs, and it's kind of cool to watch.
Well, you bring that up. I want to talk about defense next. Regular season, this Chiefs team finished fourth in yards allowed, 3,352. They finished fourth in touchdowns allowed with 19. They produced 57 sacks, which was good enough for second in the league, behind the Ravens, who had 60. I have to ask, but, I mean, this Chiefs team, are they where they are without this defense? And if so, why?
No. This defense and the unsung hero about this whole season is Brett Veach. Think about it. When Tyreek Hill left and they got those draft picks for him, right? Yep. He capitalized on all of it, and they were all on the defensive side of the ball. When you get, you know, Snead, you get McDuffie, you get George Karloftis, all those guys haven't only just contributed, they've contributed at a big-time level. They're all Pro Bowl caliber players. Cook was a big hit, and then bringing in Justin Reed. I mean, these guys. I mean, they Watson too. I mean, every time they step on the field, they're producing. How about Willie Gay? How about Nick Bolton? I mean, so that side of the ball, nobody was talking about it, but that's what Brett Veach brought to this. And so, yeah, we didn't capitalize on wide receivers or offensive tackles, although we paid a little money for them. We didn't capitalize on it, but the defensive side of the ball, which we drafted under those rookie contracts, which you can get 4 good years out of those players before they hit the market, that's what he was able to do, and I think that was a big difference.
Absolutely. We continue on the topic of defense. I bring this up as a Chiefs fan myself, but I grew up in the 90s. I hear your name. I hear Neil Smith. I hear Derek Thomas, Kevin Ross, Albert Lewis, Dale Carter. The list goes on. You guys played lights out ball for Coach Schottenheimer, who came into the organization in 1989, and the defense was just fierce. 135 sacks total for you guys in the first 3 years of Marty. You put up 10 of those yourself. My question is, what motivates a defense to play well on all cylinders in the moments throughout the season, especially when injuries take their toll or you may have a down year, kind of like what everybody thought they were doing this year?
You know, it was a little different back then. You had to draft. You had to hit on your draft choices. There wasn't much jumping around like there is now. You know, every year it's people can jump all over the place. I mean, you had to build your team through the draft. And we had some playmakers on the defensive side of the ball. And it was – we took a pride in what we did. And we knew – Marty made us – what we were and who we were. He was a linebacker, and he had that linebacker mentality. And so the way we practiced, the way we prepared, and what we did, we knew exactly if they handed the ball off and they got more than 2.5 yards per carry, we failed on that play. We knew it. I still know it to this day. 2.5 yards. You have to hold them under 2.5 yards on a rush play, right? If they run the ball three times and they get more than 2.5 yards, they got a first down. So we had to stop them. And we went into every game, hold them under 100 yards rushing, hold them under 200 yards passing. And those numbers are still ingrained to me because he ingrained them in us. And so we knew when we were playing, as soon as that play was over, we knew whether we won or lost.
Yeah.
And so if we lost, we tried even harder the next play. And that was the mentality that defense had.
Awesome. And now I'd like to talk a little offense now too. I mean, you played with a great offense. You guys could pass with DeBerg. You had the run with Ward and Okoye. I mean, do you see any similarities in the offense now with Mahomes leading, who I believe is a little bit more confident than DeBerg was, and even at the age Montana was that he came in there. But then you have Pacheco, Edwards-Helaire. I mean, as opposed to back in 1990 and 1991 seasons, I mean, I feel like these two guys are pretty powerhouse too.
I like it. I like what they've done. And you know, with that offensive line, similar to the offensive line we had back then, you lean on them a little bit. Why not? I mean, you got these guys. Let's use them. And I think that this team has taken that as a personal challenge. Mm-hmm. But, you know, Marty Ball was Marty Ball. I mean, he used to say this. He used to say this. I don't give a damn if everybody in the stadium knows we're running 35 slant or 34 slant, left and right, both sides of the – he goes, I don't care. We're running it. And so, you know, and we had Christian Okoye, and we had Barry, and we had that big offensive line with Lutz and Baldinger and Brunny. I mean, all – so – they knew it too, and they lined up, and that's what we did. Hey, I'll tell you what we're doing. We're coming right over you here. And they did it. They handed the ball off and they did it. So, that was a pretty special time. I love Steve DeBerg, but if we had had anybody that played quarterback close to what Patrick Mahomes could do, we would have gone to the dance a few times.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And on that note, we go ahead and talk coaches. You mentioned Schottenheimer's coaching strategy there a little bit. And I mean, other than Coach Reed winning Super Bowls, what's the biggest difference between Schottenheimer and Coach Reed? I mean, they're both top two winningest coaches for the franchise, so it's clearly something's going right for both of them.
They're a leader. Both of them are leaders of men. Like, you can't look in the last 18 years, there's been 135 to date to this day, 135 coaches hired in the NFL. The majority of them, 60%, are fired after year two.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a reason, because when you're in charge of 40 some coaches and 60 some players, and you're the person that's in charge, you better be a leader, because if you're not, you'll get found out real quick. You'll get exposed. Just think about your teacher when you were in school, right? Think about your teachers. You knew the ones you could get away with stuff on, right?
Yep.
And you knew the ones that meant business. You didn't challenge it. They were. And so when he stands up, when they stand up in front of a group of men and get everybody to follow what they're doing and understand what they're doing, you better be a good teacher and you better be a great leader. And that's what those two have in common.
It's awesome. Well said. Well said. I agree wholeheartedly, especially hearing stories from players in his past for Coach Reed and then getting to grow up. I actually went to fun little tidbit here. I went to school with Kim Lander's daughter, and we got to talk a few times. Just my parents talk the knowledge part. I always ask the dumb questions because I was a kid. It's like, wow, what's it like to play on Sunday? Stuff like that. But hearing the conversations that he had between parents, I mean, it was pretty awesome to hear what the coaches
were
like.
Yeah, I can imagine. Right. Yeah. Yeah. So, and you have a deep, deep respect. I can remember my coaches all through my career. My high school coach, my college coach, Jackie Sherrill, still have a great relationship with him. We talk quite regularly, Marty, and he passed away. But, yeah, I mean, that bond you have, the things you go through together collectively, I mean, those emotions, you're kind of hitched for life.
Yeah, indeed. All right. Those hard questions out of the way. We have a few fun questions for you now. So, first up, do you think the defensive tackle position has changed much since your days in the league?
Man. Yeah. Like, first and second down were always runs when I played.
Yeah.
You know, it's a different game, and I like it. I enjoy it, but it sure would be nice if I could just line up and rush the passer every play. You didn't know what you were getting. You didn't know if it was pass, and you didn't know if it was run.
Yeah.
And so you had to honor everything and play your gap responsibility to the run. I mean, if I just jumped up field all the time, I'd leave a big gap open on my side, and that would be a hole, and I wouldn't be playing very long with Marty. But yeah, it's changed a lot, because it's you know, the game is really kind of become 7-on-7. If you think about grade school, high school, all these 7-on-7 tournaments, they're everywhere across the country, right? It's quarterbacks, receivers, and secondary. And so, you know, the game has taken that on with a 20-hour rule in college football, and you know, with the time constraints with the new collective bargaining agreement in the NFL, you can't just go out there and practice for 5 hours like Marty used to do. I mean, you have 2 hours on the field. That's it. It's filmed. And so you have to condense everything into that. So, yeah, the game's changed a lot, but it's still – I'm in awe of the size of the guys that are playing now. You know, I played at 265. I couldn't play defensive tackle at 265 now. Yeah. It's different.
Indeed. I agree there too. And next up, what's your favorite memory of someone who inspired you in the game?
Man, you know, There were so many different times and so many different things over the course of my career, being in college or the guys I played with in college. Our Pitt teams were phenomenal. I mean, most of those guys ended up in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. You know, Dan Marino and Chris Dolman and Russ Grimm, and you know, it's just phenomenal. And there's being around those guys at that age, we didn't know. All we were 18, 19, 20-year-old kids, right? And but we competed, right? And we competed against each other. And everything was a competition. Every day, it didn't matter. The weight room, the training room, everything you did out on the field, it was just a competition. And lo and behold, you know, if you surround yourself with greatness, and that's basically, you know, I was fortunate enough to be around just great players. And that helps, right? You're only as good as the people around you. I mean, that's it in a nutshell. Because, you know, you can be taken defensively, you can be taken out of a game in college or pro football if, you know, if you're the one icon. You need everybody else along the way to make things even. So I was fortunate. I played with some great guys.
That's awesome. That's awesome. And last couple here. You played with Reggie White, Derek Thomas.
Yeah, there you are.
Who brought more energy to the game?
Oh, wow. Okay, so that's a good question. Energy wasn't a problem. It was the way they went about it. One was a wild man, I'll let you guess. And the other was spiritual. And you take those two things, like Derek, I mean, yeah, I wanted to be, let's go, baby. Let's go. Because he's all about full throttle, full speed ahead, everything he did in life. Till he passed away.
Yeah.
I mean, that was it. I mean, that was him. And you got juice off of that, you know? But at the same side, the Reverend, I mean, he was amazing. And if you didn't believe in the man upstairs when you're around Reggie White, and you just won't believe at all, because I mean, he pulled from that on a daily basis, and those that played with him saw it. He was amazing. He pulled from that strength, and when you were down or tired or anything, you hear him. I mean, oh, Billy Moss, come on, Billy Moss, let's go. You know, okay, Rev, let's go, baby. and yeah, so two different styles, but the same effect on anybody around him, their teammates.
All right. Well said. Well said. I like that. Wild man and obviously the minister. I mean.
Yeah.
All right. Final question. Chiefs take on the 49ers in the Super Bowl. Can the Chiefs overcome a team who is supposedly better than them? I mean, Chiefs are now apparently the underdog as we're a week out. Man. Yet again, though, same team, different quarterback. I mean, same style of play, really, and a better running back this time around. But I don't know. What's your final score and prediction here?
Yeah. So, yeah, you know, first of all, I will never bet against Patrick Mahomes. I've never seen the likes of it hitting on any level, not even close. Yeah, they're good. Their defense is good. I don't think their defense was as good as it was when we played them the first time.
Yeah.
I think they were better then. But their offense, you know, Deebo Samuel, Kittle, McCaffrey, they and that offensive line, well, I mean, they're good, right? But, I think Chiefs find a way to overcome this regardless of, you know, what the prognosticators think. I mean, the Chiefs lined up, and I've seen it too many times for too many years. I think every playoff game they've been down, right? And they find a way to come back. And I think they do it here again. I think it's going to be somewhere along the lines of 27-21.
Okay. All right. You heard it here, folks. We'll see. But we appreciate you coming on, taking the time out of your week. And, hopefully you can come back on again soon.
You got it, guys. Go Chiefs.
Go Chiefs. Great stuff from him. I mean, well, we'll go ahead and get right to it again. And now we talk big news from the Super Bowl, brought to you by Ghetto Tacos. And make sure you get on in there this weekend. Get a catering order if you can, or pop in there today, pop in there tomorrow. Get that taco meat made for your Super Bowl party, or go get those breakfast burritos that they've started serving. Oh man, those look delicious. Delicious. But anyway, Andy Reid, poor guy. I wish they would stop asking this, but at this point, I feel like it's really rude, but he's addressed it all year long. And Coach Reid addressed this topic on retirement by sharing his received advice from a long time ago from his parents that he is now using that time coming for him to decide. And I mean, here's what he had to say. Kansas City Chiefs, or they asked him if he wanted to coach the Chiefs again and if he'd be there next season. And then he goes, well, my mom and dad told me this when they were working. And Reid said, as the Chiefs prepare for the Super Bowl, and he goes, they said, you'll know when it's time. And I'm ready to go right now. So let's go. And that's what they would tell me when I was younger. I mean, I was an inquisitive kid. And that's the way I look at it. So somewhere you're going to know when it's time. Today's not that day. And Chiefs Chairman Clark Hunt said he received no indication from Reid that the coach is preparing to retire. And he said, I don't have a sense for what he's thinking, Hunt said. I do know he's really engaged, enjoying it. I have no sense that he's going to be ready to retire in the near future. But in terms of how long it goes, I don't know. Certainly, I hope it's a long time in the future, but we'll just have to see as we go. And he was asked that and possible departure. And I mean, he also said that he felt it's too early to start worrying about that at this point. It would definitely be premature. And it's really starting to tick me off that they won't leave the guy alone. And I mean, that's for me as well. And then you get a premature Adam Schefter saying that Bill Belichick, this came out last week, would be a good fit for Kansas City when Andy departs. And I'm like, dude, quit with your false retirement reports. Your sources suck. You don't know when anyone is retiring. You're speculating on almost every retirement you have announced. I mean, just stop it. Like, as a fan, as another guy in the media here, it's ridiculous. Like, he called Jason Kelsey. He called Tom Brady. Tom Brady proved him wrong and came back for another year. And then Jason Kelsey, as of right now, he says he's good to go. He likes all the coaching stuff going on. We talked about it last week. He's in favor of everything that they're doing. So I'm not really sure where Schefter keeps coming from with these false things. I mean, and then he goes, per sources. It's like, so who is your source? Like a dog from 10,000 miles away that could hear? But what are your thoughts here? Yeah. I mean,
well, yeah, I think it might have been the dog that was the source. No. Yeah. But the funny thing is most of this stuff has come from like one source, basically. It's funny how sometimes these things happen where it's like, and it's kind of equally the media members that are like the press people that are there who keep it going, who light the fire, that is like kind of their fault. Even if they're like, well, I didn't say it. I'm just asking the question, but it's like, okay, but if only one, I think it started with Mike Florio, maybe.
Yeah.
Pro Football Talk guy. He's the one that said, like, I have a feeling we look at Andy Reid, he's getting older. And then from that, people took it like it's this thing that's in the air, like gospel. It's like one guy, it'd be like if you said, you know, I don't know.
Why did nobody ever do this with Joe Gibbs? That's my question.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, I definitely could do that. But in general, it kind of feels like it's almost like another theory is that the fact that they've had so much success in a small amount of time that it's almost like, well, your brain wants to go to, he must be retiring soon because they're about to win their third Super Bowl. You know, it's like, but in reality, it's like, well, he's only 64 and it's, you know, Pete Carroll was 72. It's not like he's been coaching the Chiefs for 90 years or anything. So but it feels like it because they're on their fourth Super Bowl.
Well, and can you believe they've even asked Travis Kelce this also? Like,
yeah,
okay, no, he starts dating a girl, oh, your career's done, all right, what are we doing?
Yeah again, it's like people want the conversation. Even Jason Kelce, who's like might actually retire, but like the people who are just like, and it's happening. And
yeah,
anyways, yeah, I feel like there's the retiring stuff literally just came from it almost feels silly to talk about. It'd be like if you said Creed Humphrey. Did you hear that Creed Humphrey killed a baby?
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, did you hear the news? It's like, well, no, West said that as a joke, and now it's become, you know what I mean? It's
Dude,
like,
this
it's like,
just in, actually, Creed Humphrey's eating steak right now. Per sources, oh. Per sources.
Yeah, see, okay, so I'm going to put that online, and then that's at the Super Bowl. Then literally, that's how social media works now. At the Super Bowl, it's going to be like, so there's been word that, like, you were eating a steak last night, and you've got, it's like one person said it. And
how'd you know? Did the steak, did the cow moo at you?
Oh, yeah, I guess that's the other aspect. Maybe Andy Reid has only told Mike Florio that, hey, I'm thinking about retiring and nobody else, but probably not. My bet would be is that he, like, doesn't want to say absolutely no in case the, you know, something happens with his life and he does retire, but he's absolutely. Like, but it's obviously like, what would entice you about me retiring? Like are you saying my play calling's bad, or what are you saying?
Someone offered me cheeseburgers and State Farm. I'm down.
even Belichick, who is 72, I just want to say, maybe 70, maybe Pete Carroll is 72, maybe he's 70.
Yeah, both
it's
of
like,
them are.
But it's like, he didn't necessarily, if you watch the Patriots and the talent they have, he didn't necessarily have a bad year.
No.
He still had a significant defense with not a lot of talent. Yeah. They did what they could do. They have a terrible quarterback. It's like, what are they supposed to do? Like, win the Super Bowl? So it's like, even at 70, who's 6 years older than Andy Reid, he still was like kind of almost still Bill Belichick.
Yeah.
So this idea that it's like he's 64, so bye-bye Andy Reid, is like, anyways, I just think it's funny because it's like the Chiefs have had so much success that it's like something needs to be stirred up that feels like it's coming to an end. And Kelsey feels more realistic than Andy Reid, if you ask me, actually.
Yeah.
Like, I could see Travis being like, you know what, I am kind of getting beaten up, and now I have all these opportunities for things, and I'm going to retire. But Andy Reid retiring for no reason at 64 just seems like so random, unless he has like some like family issues.
He's feeling 22. He'll stay.
There you go. You were waiting for that one. But yeah. That's my thought on that. Randy, please stay for 6 more years.
Yeah, I agree.
At least.
And then Belichick can take over. Oh, wait. No, he won't, because he's older than Coach Reed. And
whatever. That's the other part, too. Like, I could see him staying as long as he can. Like, it's such a rare opportunity. It'd be one thing if it's like Mike Tomlin, who's like, he's doing a good job with this team he has, and he loves Pittsburgh. But when you're in like this rare opportunity where you have Mahomes, and I would even say you have Mahomes and you have this lucky situation where Spags doesn't want to, he's not going to be head coach anymore because he already did all of that. So he wants to stay here and be like, it's the perfect scenario where you got arguably the best quarterback of all time and one of the best defensive coordinators of all time, who's not going to leave because he's already done a bunch of other stuff and he's older. So the best case scenario would be like, why would I retire and like go to training camps and help us? Like, why would I not just, anyways, unless it's like diabetes gets to him or something. But
speaking of eating and food there, last night, Keegan-Michael Peele had one of the best jokes about DeVito and Spagnuolo. Spagnuolo, Mike DeVito would eat that.
Oh, yeah, there we go.
All right.
Wait, was he in Vegas?
Yeah. He was hosting the honors last night.
Oh, that's right. But wait, I'm seeing awards. The podcast people get this in real time. I'm seeing awards going on right now.
Yeah.
Is there like an NFL? Oh, okay.
Yep.
Maybe that's happening. It's not the ESPYs, but it's a different NFL awards for.
Yeah.
Because like CJ Stroud just won Offensive Rookie of the Year. Will Anderson just won Defensive Rookie of the Year.
Yeah.
So I just saw that pop in my feed. But the funny part about that is the Chiefs got nothing and they're in the Super Bowl. Spags didn't get even a nomination for assistant. Mahomes didn't get it for quarterback. It's like craziness.
The way everybody's been talking, shouldn't Mahomes be up for comeback player of the year? I mean,
exactly. Well, next year he will be. That'd be hilarious next year. After that, after what he had to deal with last year, even though they won a Super Bowl. No, I don't know. Who knows? The 49ers might beat us. But it's just kind of funny that, like, the fact that we're in a Super Bowl. And to be honest, you know, we haven't talked to each other in a while. So, it's like, this is kind of, as we gear up for the Super Bowl, this can kind of be a review of the season as well. Because, there definitely were moments, specifically the Christmas Day game, where I was not like, oh, 100% we're going to go to the Super Bowl. I don't care. But this, like, there was definitely a part of me that's like, man, maybe we just, our receivers are letting us down so much. And there's such a bad vibe that we're just kind of like, it kind of felt like we were just falling into the playoffs and like next year will be our year. That was kind of, there's a bunch of bad vibes happening and our offensive line is not the way we thought it would be. And we're getting sacks and turnovers and our receivers can't catch. So maybe like, how are we going to win three games in a row? It didn't happen. So it's like, it's not like I saw a lot of like people pulling receipts on Twitter and stuff. And it's like, I gotta be honest. I wasn't like, there's no way we're winning the Super Bowl, but I was kind of one of those people that was like, what is going on here? But that being said, Mahomes was definitely the wild card and he came through and we had it in the back of our head last year that Spagnuolo and Andy Reid, but Spagnuolo in the playoffs does have a different, like he no longer is experimenting. He now is just in full on what are the best plays and best moves. And it's like, whoa, is this, even though he's been great all year, but I think the same for Andy Reid. I think they use the regular season as practice, as lame as that sounds. I think they do like, let's try to get Justin Ross some stuff. Okay, let's try to get Richie James some stuff. And then when the playoffs hit, it's just like, okay, no, only Rashee Rice, only Pacheco, maybe a few to Justin Watt. We're just doing what works.
Yep.
But we always fall for it, right, in the regular season. We're like, when you see a loss on Christmas Day, the Raiders, you're like, it must be that something's going on. There's no way we can fix it. But a lesson for next year.
Next up, we talk 49ers, and once again, grass is being complained about, and last year it was the Super Bowl turf, which, I mean, I agree with. Both teams were just all around. It was bad. Yeah. But the 49ers are complaining about the practicing at the University of Las Vegas, Nevada, saying that the fields are not up to par to practice on, and saying that it is a huge disadvantage when trying to prepare for a big game. And then Roger Goodell fired back, stating that the field met proper requirements and they had 23 experts out there. The players' union was out there, and then the union said they didn't sign off but refused to comment on the matter. So, well, okay. But this is the second year in a row it will be played in a dome with natural turf and a rollaway field with proper watering and sunlight outside. And then, yeah, I don't know. What are your thoughts here? Are they trying to stir up trouble again and blame it on the NFL for a possible Chiefs win, or is it just all talk?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if it'll be interesting if the Chiefs win, if there'll be any salty Niners fans who say, like in the post game conference, say, I doubt they'll say it now because they don't want to give any, you know what I mean? They don't want to give any juice to like, they're cheating. And it's like, you don't want to give the Chiefs any fire. But like, anyways, but there might just be a chance where it is just a real thing of like, look, we're not saying anything suspicious is going on, but this is, we were expecting firmer field. And this, anyways, it seems a little petty. And it also, it might've been a thing where, maybe I'm wrong, but it might've been a thing where a coach said it kind of offhandedly, and then a reporter took it to mean like they were pissed off.
Yep.
And it might have just been like, oh, I was just saying that kind of like, it's unfortunate, but not like I want the world to know about this. So
all,
who knows?
All the feelers are definitely out there. Like, I mean,
exactly. Especially
I'm surprised it wasn't broken by Adam Schefter. So
yeah, it's true. The amount of mundane news I've heard during the Super Bowl week, it's the one downside of it being 2 weeks where it's like I can only handle so much like Chiefs updates and like the strategy for this game. And it's like, like 2 weeks in, you're like, all right, let's just play the game already. I can't hear about like they've moved their media to 8:00, which means their practice will now be at, it's like, all right, okay. We'll forget about this in a month. But anyways, it might be one of the things, but I'll be interested to see if it's like, if like they play slow footed or if it actually affects their game and they're like, darn it, we couldn't practice as well because our field was slightly altered. So we'll see.
Well, and then we move on from negative to positive, and now we get to talk Missouri native players playing in the Super Bowl. And I came across this stat this week and thought it would be pretty cool to talk about because, I mean, highlighting players from Missouri on each team. So first up, the 49ers have one. KC native from Park Hill, wide receiver Ronnie Bell. I mean, he's contributed quite a bit to the team this year. And then the Chiefs, you have Mizzou native Nick Bolton. You have quarterback Blaine Gabbert, who graduated from Parkway West, by the way, and then played for Mizzou. And then you have Felix Nduke Uzuma, born in Kansas City and went to Lee Summit West High School. And then, now he's playing for the Chiefs, went to K-State briefly. And then lastly, you have Tershawn Wharton, who was a D2 guy. Pretty impressive, though. He played from Missouri S&T in Rolla. So it's awesome. I mean, five guys from Missouri in the Super Bowl last year. I mean, they had Bolton and Wharton. So yeah, that's awesome.
Oh, yeah. And still have the guy from Missouri State on the practice squad.
Yes.
Not sure that counts, but.
I mean, at this point in the year, it might.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure he talks about it. It's like, I technically was there during Super Bowl week.
Yeah.
But yeah, good for good Missouri. Good Missouri sports time, kind of in general. You know, you got
It's awesome.
Mizzou had one of their best years ever. Yeah, they got the Chiefs are like in the apex of. I mean, if they can finish off this Super Bowl like the one of the best runs ever. I know it's been talked about a lot, but it's like legit. Like I was watching. I had the NFL Network on. They had like. The NFL films of every single Super Bowl in a row, like starting with Super Bowl one, and then it's like, and you are watching it, and it's like, in some ways, it's not that much different. It's kind of cool watching it. It's like the same kind of problem, same kind of blitz packages that they're using, and this team was good at this and that.
Weird.
And even then, they're like the run the Chiefs are doing now is still like the Steelers kind of did it in the 70s. The Niners certainly were kind of in that. It was basically like all of the 80s. The Niners were decently good. But this run of just like almost every year we're in the Super Bowl is like kind of unprecedented. So it's almost like too much, like to the point where it's like we got to the Super Bowl and it was like, there we go. Good job. Good job. You know what I mean?
Indeed.
Whereas 5 years ago, me and you would have been like, oh, my God, we are in the Super Bowl. Like this is like, the you know, like if the Lions would have got in now, it's like, phew, that was close. OK, we're back in the Super Bowl.
Yep.
It's like we're so spoiled with how good we are that it's like normal that we've gotten in the Super Bowl. So I try not to take it for granted, even like this Super Bowl week with all the interviews, and I try not to take it for granted.
Yeah.
And it probably makes it that much better when you have, you know, someone like Felix and Anduke Uzama in there who lived there their whole life. And now that, and with a menu, how has a chance to actually make an impact.
Last year I was watching on my couch, man, and now I'm here.
If he actually like had like a significant sack in this game because Minihue was out, that would be like the best. That would be the ultimate way to wrap up the season of like the one rookie who didn't really, or the one player who didn't really do anything this year was Felix. And then he comes in the last game in the Super Bowl and makes like a game
sealing
sack.
He showed a lot of sparks early,
Kurt.
But then they took him out for Imanihue when Imanihue came back. So,
yeah. And understandably so. He's 21 years old. He was definitely like, they got him as a project. Like he was young. I think he like was 20 basically the whole time he was at Kansas State. So it was kind of like Karloftis last year, except we have way more talent this year. So there wasn't really room for him to like come in and steal spots from Mike Dana. But now he's going to come in and there'll probably be a mixture of Dana.
Even Dana stepped it up this year. He looked great early.
Exactly. So there wasn't really room for like, sorry, you're out. We got to put this rookie in who is 21 and still learning. Like it seems like he's from the few snaps I've seen, he's still learning like the moves of the NFL.
Yep.
But who knows? Maybe he'll come in. But yeah, good for Missouri.
Indeed. Next up, we go ahead and talk the injury front and 49ers. Trent Williams didn't practice. Lazy. Doesn't want to do it. So they told him he could have time off.
Hey, when you're old, you get that.
Yeah, exactly. Armstead, Burks, Kittle, Thomas, Davis. They're all out. Limited in practice. They participated in needed drills, but the rest of the time they pretty much just stood there. Tooney, he's out for sure. Andy Reid pretty much confirmed it. Then McKinnon is back and limited, but they said that he probably will play on Sunday. So fingers crossed for that one to get the trifecta back there with McKinnon, Pacheco, and Edwards-Helaire. That'd be awesome. Excuse me.
Go ahead.
Oh, no. Last I've got is full participation. I mean, everybody that came back. I mean, James, he's back. Moore, Pacheco, Snead, Prince, Jones. Everybody's good to go.
Yeah. And, the only slight one was I think like an hour ago, Rashee Rice popped up for like an ankle thing. But it's nothing like, all the coaches have said it was just like a precautionary.
He'll probably sit till Sunday.
Yeah. And he's been like... it seems like every game this playoffs, he'll make a great catch and then kind of get up gimpy. I can't tell if it's just like the way he walks, but like every play,
sometimes,
it's like, oh,
no,
I'll be like, weird. Oh, no, Rashee. But then the next play he's in and he makes a big play. It's like, oh, I guess he was okay. But why'd he walk like that?
I guarantee he got concussed in that game.
Oh, man.
His head was so, he's just like,
You got hit every which way.
Okay.
Yeah. So they're probably playing it safe. I mean, it's he is an important piece though. So
yeah.
When that news first popped up, people probably were like, "Oh God, don't be something that
they're trying to get you there." They're trying to get you in there, Adam Schefter again.
Yeah, exactly. the McKinnon one though was like amazing. Like that was like a surprise gift. It's like I wasn't even thinking about McKinnon anymore. No. I just had him at him. It was like,
Sky Moore too. I didn't even think anything about him.
Sky Moore, I thought a little bit had a chance. I think it's also more so just that McKinnon actually I think has a bigger role than Sky Moore does.
Oh yeah.
Now it might be different since he's so rusty. I'm not sure if he'll be like every play he's out there making a big block on Nick Bosa, but I think he will. I think he is a significant part of, you know, pass protection, and that'd be funny if that was like a you know, a card they've been holding all week of like the Niners have not been practicing for what if we have McKinnon out there instead of Clyde Edwards-Helaire. So that was cool.
Absolutely. I mean, just those little things, you know. I mean,
it really is.
Vegas is the place of where magic's hidden, so people can't see it. So
there you go.
But bold predictions coming up here in a minute. Real quick, we'll briefly touch on what's going on. I mean, it's a heck of a weekend. They're calling it the trifecta, but you got the power slap competition. Then you have, and that's on Friday, and then on Saturday you have the UFC big fights. That's gonna be legit. And then you got the Super Bowl on Sunday. So if you're there, and then you have the honors tonight. So that's like 4 days of big events. So I don't know. That's, if you're there, cool. That's awesome. But if you're at home, you don't really get to see all that. So I'll be waiting for the power slap competitions to pop up on Twitter. That'll be fun. But and on social media in general.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
UFC, I'll just pay attention to ESPN on that one. I don't really have any fights to pay attention to this weekend. I mean, they got a few big ones, but nothing that really caught my eye. So
I have no idea.
But here you go. Prediction time. Who you got this weekend?
I'm going to take the I'm going to take Neosho over Carl Junction. I think they have a higher you mean the Chiefs game. Yeah, I think there's a part of me that like there's almost too much even though technically the Niners are actually, I mean the Chiefs are actually underdogs in terms of Vegas lines, we're underdogs, but a lot of this is the first game in the playoffs where it's like there's a lot of Chiefs hype, I should say. Yeah. Whereas pretty much every game before this was like this is where it comes falling down for the Chiefs because they secretly suck. Now it's the opposite where it's like the Niners kind of got here fraudulently and the Chiefs are going to win it, which makes me a little bit nervous. Like I feel like we need to have a little bit of a chip instead of just like, of course the Chiefs are going to win.
Yeah.
But I do think, assuming everything stays the same with the way it looked in the playoffs, which sometimes in the Super Bowl it changes, I do think we can take advantage of that defense, assuming the one hitch on this is kind of a long answer. Sorry. But the one hitch I'll give is that maybe not the Packers, actually, but I feel like the tackles for the Lions and Packers have been playing better than Donovan Smith. Maybe not. I take that back. I say that because they kind of held Nick Bosa well.
Yeah.
And if you not literally held him illegally, but, you know, held him up. And if you can hold Nick Bosa up, then their cornerbacks are not as good this year. So that's, but if we can't, and it's like every snap, Nick Bosa is turning around Juwan Taylor and Mahomes is running. Yeah. No matter how bad their defense was, if that keeps happening, then that could. And then now he's throwing it to Richie James, who drops it. It's like there's a way this could go badly if our tackles are bad. But if we can even somewhat have, especially with McKinnon here, which is kind of, that's a secret sauce to chip help. I just think Andy Reid is too smart for these cornerbacks and the way their defense has been playing. Unless they like Steve Wilkes, the defensive coordinator, has a completely different game plan that he's been saving up.
Very well, could.
Even though he was down 17, so it makes no sense that he's been saving this up. But
yeah.
So yeah, I feel like the Chiefs should win it. I'm not, but all the reasons I gave before about how it could go bad are still there. So it's not like we're going to win 44-10. No way. I mean, this is a talent that technically the superstars, there's more superstars on the Niners than there are the Chiefs. I feel like not by a lot. I mean, we got Snead, Jones. I think McDuffie's a superstar, but offensively, I mean, like it's a little different than the Ravens where it's like, that was more of a system and Lamar.
Yeah.
This one's like, they have four guys who could just on their own make an awesome, you know, Deebo Samuel, Christian McCaffrey, like they could do a spin move and go for 60 yards, even if the scheme was good by Spagnuolo.
Is Deebo going to be playing? I didn't catch.
Yep, Debo's playing, he's which in. Stinks.
Okay.
I mean, it doesn't stink. We want the best competition, but
yeah,
that will make it tougher. I trust Spagnuolo. I feel like running teams like this with a quarterback that's not like elite, not going to say he's bad. I know there's a lot of discussion about that, but that's like, I feel like Spagnuolo can work around that of like, if you're just going to find ways to get it to Debo, our defense will defend that well. So
yeah,
I'm picking because I have to, because I feel terrible if I pick the Niners, even if they won. I couldn't in my brain be pick the Niners. So I'm going to pick the Chiefs. I'm going to say 24-20.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right. Big reveal.
Let's see.
Big reveal. Okay. Ready?
You put on a Niners cap. Okay. Wait, you took off your Chiefs cap to put on another Chiefs cap.
Gold and red. That's going to be the winner.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. How's that go?
No. You got to go. You got to go bright, gaudy red. Gold, not
golden
maroon red.
I'm just sticking with gold and red. All right.
Got to go yellow. Cheating. Cheating.
But on that note, yeah, I'll go Chiefs and going to say by a field goal. That's what it's been. So
yeah, I could see that.
Bucker wins it, gets it late. And yeah, so we'll head into the local sports update brought to you by Trackside Burgers. They are open at 1515 West 10th Street in Joplin. Go get one of Chef Mike's specialties today and through the rest of the weekend. And I think they're, I don't remember if you had to have your orders in yet, but they were making some ribs and I believe some pulled pork for the big game on Sunday. So go get you some if you can, because it's delicious. And on the boys' side, for basketball, Joplin heads to Willard tonight. Neosho heads to Ozark. Carthage heads to Nixa. CJ heads to Branson. Webb heads to Republic. Everybody in Southwest Missouri is on the road. And all those games will begin at 7:30. As for the girls' side, we have a special interview real quick with Diamond Girls basketball seniors Grace Fraizer and Lauren Turner on their season at hand. Go ahead and take a look. We bring in Diamond Girls basketball players Grace Fraizer and Lauren Turner. How are you?
Doing good. How are you?
Oh, definitely ready for this weekend. You guys Chiefs fans, not Chiefs fans?
Yes,
we are.
And, well, I guess I'll have to ask that now then. How's Coach holding up?
Oh, you know, the Raiders fans aren't doing too well.
Yeah.
Do you guys give them a hard time for that?
All the time. All right. Not just for that.
Fair enough. That's good. Yeah. That's good camaraderie right there for sure. But, all right, well, we'll go ahead and get to it. Highlight last season a little bit. In 22-6 season, y'all helped the high school capture its first district title since 1986, 37 years. What went through your all's heads last year after that title game?
So that was, like, definitely a huge highlight for our program. It was really, really cool to see our community just back us up in that game. And it was super competitive, obviously. Lamar always brings a good competition. So, yeah. And I think all of our girls were just excited in the moment to be there and be able to be a part of it. So,
yeah, I mean, that was the first time for basketball we'd experienced getting that far, a big win like that. And I think it really set higher goals for this year's team.
Awesome. And unfortunately, y'all lost the next game to Fairgrove. But that aside, we move into this season. Y'all are currently 20-2. Besides returning all of your starters from last season, what's led to the success of this season so far?
Yeah, so last year was great. But this year, all of our girls, we really bought in. We knew, like, last year we were good, and we knew this year we could be even better. We had the same girls, and we knew this is our year to do it if we're going to go far.
Yeah.
Awesome. And what is the team's mindset now that the regular season is closing to an end? Is it another district title that's on the mind, or is it further than that for sure?
So, I mean, definitely you gotta get to certain points first. So district is definitely our main goal right now, and really even finishing up our last games in the season. But yeah, district is super, super big goal for us. It's going to be really, really good games. Clever's really good competition, and that's who we expect to see. So, yeah.
All right. Now I want to move on to the personal accomplishments. Lauren, we'll go you first just because it happened this week. But 1,000 points scored in your career. What a feat. I mean, I always find it amazing when you guys in high school scoring 1,000 points. I mean, not only is that an accomplishment for you, but for your team, because they're able to get you in that position. My question is, how does it feel, and what's helped you become such an effective scorer in the games?
I mean, it feels amazing. That was one of my main goals was this year, you know, was we want to win districts, we want to go far, but a personal one was to get 1,000 points. And just my team this year, I mean, that game, they fed me, they knew what they were going to do. And yeah, it helps a lot having the team there that can back you up. And then now having, you know, two girls that have scored 1,000 points or more on our team, it's crazy to think about what we could do.
Yeah, that is awesome. And Grace, it's your turn now. You're coming off a career high 34 points in a game. And I mean, how does that feel? And was there any extra motivation behind that effort? Or was it just one of those nights like, all right, yeah, I'm feeling it. Can you bring it over here a little bit?
Yeah, so definitely just it's a lot of adrenaline going through you. So definitely you feel some nights more than others. But yeah, the Miller game, they're always super competitive. So we knew we all had to show up, all five of us. So, and, you know, 34 points can't happen without four other girls who have your back. So
awesome. Well said. And last up, I'd like to go ahead and talk what's next. And Grace, you're extending your career to play collegiately at MSSU next year. That team is something else right now. I mean, what they're putting together, what they've accomplished over the last few years. I mean, I can see the decision on why you'd want to go there and join that hype. But what kind of helped with your decision, and what are you looking forward to next year?
Yeah, they're having a great season this year. So that's really exciting to just see that that's the program that I'm going to be brought into. And I feel like I'm already really a part of it. It just really feels like home already. So I think that was a big part of the decision. You know, it's only about 30 minutes away, so it's not too far. But yeah, they definitely feel like home. So I'm really excited to get started with them.
Awesome. And Lauren, for you, basketball, softball, you're very talented in both sports. Are you looking to continue in one of those collegiately? And if so, do you have any offers you're looking into currently?
Yeah, so softball is definitely more my thing. I love basketball, but it's always been my thing. I have a few offers that I'm kind of looking into, but I'm just hoping, you know, I know our season with our team we're going to have is going to go well this year. So after that, I'm really excited to see where I'll be going.
That's awesome. Good to hear, and we'll be ready for that on here, and hopefully have you back on to talk about that experience too. So, but again, congratulations on your all season, and I guess we'll go one final thing since we started off with Chiefs. Do you guys have any predictions for Sunday?
Oh gosh,
Chiefs all the way,
like scoring predictions.
Yeah, we'll go that far. We'll go that far.
Oh, I have no clue. I'll say like 31-21 Chiefs. That's okay. My prediction.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, sounds about right to me.
So, yep. Is Coach Atten up there? Can he give his?
He's right behind the camera.
You want to say hi?
I got 49ers by 7.
Oh.
Okay. Okay. Hey, I mean, it is what it is. I like it. 49ers by 7 could be very real. So, but we'll yeah, see. You guys have a good rest of the season. Good rest of your weekend. And yeah. Hope to have you all back on.
All right. Thank you so much.
Yeah. And great stuff from them. I mean, Coach Atnip has a great thing going, and I really appreciate how he is just motivating these girls and keeping them in a winning way. I mean, 3 years in a row, really four. I mean, he's just gotten that program turned around, and I can't wait to see the future of that program. And, well, only girls action we have tonight is Joplin girls head to Willard. And they will play just before the boys for a super night up at Willard. And then we head into the 2-minute warning brought to you by Hot Stone Pizzeria. Not feeling like cooking this weekend? Go grab some pizza by the slice over there. And Wednesday through Saturday. So, yeah, they're also going to be open for the big game. So make sure you get your orders in for some delicious pizza. They got some new specials going, so be sure to check it out. MSSU women will be home again this weekend. They host Central Missouri at 1:30 p.m. The men will follow, and 15-game winning streak there. And I'm excited to be in attendance for this one, so we'll see how it goes. And then 3-2 MSSU baseball will host their first homestand of the 2024 season as they will host Ochita Baptist today at 3 p.m., tomorrow at 1 p.m., and Sunday at 1 p.m., and then the 5-0 softball team from Missouri Southern will head back to Arkansas as they will head to the Alvie Early Memorial Classic. Today will be a doubleheader. They will play the University of Texas at Tyler at 11 a.m., then they will play Truman State at 1:30 p.m. Tomorrow at 11 a.m., they will take on the University of Illinois Springfield and at 11 a.m. for that one, and then SBU at 1:30, and then on Sunday, they will take on Missouri S&T at 11 a.m. with Southeastern Oklahoma State at 1:30 after that game. And, well, music's here, so it's the end of another episode. For Tony, Clint, Jensen, myself, have a great and safe weekend. Snow's in the forecast, so be sure to have a lot of fun for the Super Bowl. And be safe out there. Don't drink and drive. Don't drink and drive. Just get that designated driver, get that friend, or stay at your friend's house and sleep on their couch and just don't leave. So
absolutely.
But also don't forget, go get ghetto tacos this weekend. Tonight, they got 10% burritos, 10% off of burritos. And then you can go get in this weekend for that. But Taco Tuesday, Thirsty Thursdays, one free drink per entree on Thirsty Thursdays. So, yeah. All right. Well, we'll catch you next week on the Sports Timeout.
Bye. Go Chiefs.
Chiefs.